Hey there, team. Something a little bit different here. This is a video I'm just going to make to really go along with Scout's recent video about a siege on Dale. I'm very sorry about my sort of recent absence. I got struck down with a pretty nasty cold this week, and it's really sort of stopped me from being able to record anything. So I'm hoping to really make a few videos this weekend. I'm hoping to get one out every day, so Friday, Saturday and Sunday, pumping something out. I would really, really recommend watching Scout's video first before this. I'm going to do this much more in the style of a What Was I Thinking? So we're not going to be looking much over anything else. I'm not even going to go through an army run through. So I'm Orcs of the Misty Mountains here, which is definitely my favourite attacking army to go for in a siege. You've always got so many troops that you can kind of use and waste a little bit, but not waste. You know, if you lose half your army, you're really not too worried because you probably lost the crap half. I've got 3 insta trolls and a lot of fodder, with a few handful of elite units dotted around. What I like to do with Dale, because Dale has got working towers, I like to get stuck in right away. Those towers are just providing the defenders with 3 kills, and I don't want that. You know, they're not using up any ammunition, and they're killing some of my boys. So I just want to get stuck in as quick as I can. So I get these towers pushed up and get some troops moved up as quickly as I can. Lucky for me, Thranduil is not holding the towers, or he's not holding the walls. That's the powder cart going off over there, gets that door open nice and quick. I have an angry cat walking around. I'm hoping she's not going to... Jazzers! I hope she's not going to bite me too much. Okay, I'm probably not going to be able to use my WASD too much, but we'll see how it goes. So as you say, I'm moving up quite quick. Thranduil is not holding these walls, which is great. So those towers are not functioning against me, and also I'm not going to have a fight. I'm going to have to fight my cat in a minute, though, aren't I, Jasmine? So she's off now. She's bored. So that's great for me, because I've got a lot of throwing weapons, and I can just batter down on that position. Now, as the dwarves, you kind of do want to hold those sorts of choke points, but you need to be very careful about can the enemy throw stuff at you. So since I'm not really getting a fight here, and my ally over on the front is getting a hell of a fight, I want to go and help a bit. So I'm getting my nice fast moving trolls running over there. I like to think I've gotten a bit better with trolls recently. I've gotten over my fear with using trolls wrong. So I'm getting these cave trolls running over, because what I like to use them now for is generally if a battle zone, if a conflict has no armor piercing units involved in it, I'll throw my trolls in. Even if it's in this nice early stage of a battle, these elven units, as skilled as they are, they're not armor piercing. So if I just get my trolls jumping on in there, they can do a lot of damage very quickly, and they won't suffer too much for it. Over here I'm getting my Mount Uruk Host. They're exposing their backs right now, so I was a bit worried that somebody's going to be coming at me there. They've got a shield, but it's not a great shield really. I'm relying on them to do a bit of my killing. Here they're having a much worse time of it with this axe fire. That's a good use of his fire to just mince my boys. Again, back shots, no shields coming into play. Yeah, so I just get them running on down as fast as I can. What I want to be doing with these walls is just getting my crossbowmen up nice and quick, which I am here. And something I was going to say, I do like when people do try and defend the outer walls of Dale. It is the sensible thing. I can't deny that. It's the sensible thing to ignore the outer walls altogether and just defend the second layer. Defending outside, there's just so much space out here. The walls are so long that you can't really defend all of it. Which means we can do things like what we're doing with what we're about to here with Mirkwood, where I'm getting my Mount Uruk host over there to backstab them now. Now the Ents are coming in, throwing the men around, of course not doing damage. These strong warriors, yeah, just getting turned back, it's tough to fight a unit like, well, a Mirkwood force like this, an Elven force. You know, you need to be coming in with just heavily armoured guys. Like, well, the trolls in a sense, they're very heavily armoured. With their rock-like skin. And I'm going to be sending my other unit of trolls over there in a minute too, because I'm seeing sort of how useful they are over there. And I really don't want to be sending my trolls forward into axe fire, and I knew that the dwarves would have some various tools to mess me up. Now that I've pierced through that gate, though, I've just got no need to engage right now. I've got my crossbows set up here, now they've taken supreme losses, and this is something that I'm definitely a bit too comfortable with. You know, just allowing my units like crossbows or things like that to just take arrow fire. You know, I always think I'd much rather they're shooting my range units than they're shooting my my melee units. And they're throwing their axes, my crossbows are dropping like flies. So of course, maybe because of the real killing power of those crossbows, I should have been more careful with them. But yeah, in my mind, as long as I still have 20 crossbows left from that unit, they're going to do some damage. So I'm happy enough to lose them. Something I'd love to do with Dale sometimes, just to try and make the defenders feel they should defend the outer walls, is try and play with civilians or something like that. Say the defenders have 3 civilians, and they can only fall back to the inner layers after those civilians have, say, carried out a route around Dale or something like that. In the sense, just gathering up the civilians and running inside. And it just means that they've got a reason to hold the outer walls, and maybe they're given some money to in order to try and offset that a bit, but I don't know. A lot of trolls dropping there, as I say, they may not be AP units here, but they're good elven units that are going to do some damage. But I'm pretty happy with how much I've done in response to it. What are we at generally now? 7-7. As I say, my focus at this time was not on the rest of the settlement. I was only really looking here and on the south. I wasn't really paying attention to what was going on over on the east or on the north. Let's just have a quick look. But as I say, I'm not. This isn't really what this battle report is about. It is much more about just what I'm up to. Cool. Now back to me. I'm getting an engagement now with my Mountain Uruk host, actually going facing off against the sentries of Khazad-dûm. This is normally something that I really wouldn't like to do. I don't like sending men at arms at the front of a pike line, but in this scenario, I always find when pikes are on a slant, when they're not on even ground, they're always just nowhere near as effective, even when they've got the high ground. I think it's maybe the stabbing animation doesn't really work because the units lower down, so I'm having some success, but as I say, it's mainly just to keep them there and gather them up, trying really to blob my enemy up right now, so that when I get my snag of skirmishers moved up, I can do some good work with them. This is actually armor upgraded, actually is it? I might be lying there. They're very brown. No, but I'm not seeing any helmets. No, that's not an armor upgraded force. Speaking of snaga, I'm starting to get mine up now. Can take a while for this full unit to climb up that one ladder, but luckily they are able to just insert themselves inside each other's. I was about to get rude there. But they can insert themselves inside each other, all the same. Cave trolls moving up this. Oh no, they're moving in right in the main gate. I don't know if that was my intention or not, because I was mainly focusing over there, and I have said this before. I really tend to just fire and forget with my cave trolls. I might have just given this order and told them to run and looked away, but no, I think this was where I wanted them. The Gamprim here, I felt they would be winning this, but they were having some trouble, so I just threw my trolls in just to wipe out the Blades of Emmendure. Again, a non-AP unit, a skilled non-AP unit. I think the trolls are just great up against those sorts of units. When I say skilled, I don't mean an elite, though. I think an elite is always going to be able to wipe out some trolls, even if they don't have AP. He was able to pull off a great surround on my host and just eviscerate them. I was trying to rescue them with the Blackback Mount Berserkers, but I was having a lot of trouble just buzzing back and forth across here. It just took so long to like get them into that gate. That was a bit of a pain in the butt, but hey, everything went out okay in the end. So I'm trying to break that position now with these spears pushing forward, but I guess it's kind of going uphill, and as good as heavy goblin spears are, they're not going to be able to push as well as a lot of the dedicated pushing men at arm units. And to be honest, as well, I'm pushing into dwarves, so that ain't going to go well. But these heavy goblin spears are AP, so I'm pretty happy enough having them in the front line, even if the dwarves are winning right now. But as I say, the main damage here is going to be coming from my javelin throwing Snaga skirmishers, who are coming in with some rapid fire volleys there. It's like, oh, that's great. That's really cool. They've got like timed so that like, it's like ripple fire pretty much. Well, not really ripple fire, but you know, my Napoleonic Wars shenanigans. I do miss all that. But that was an age ago, of course. They will be getting responded to by these axes. I was so surprised by the range of these units when they were coming at me. I'm surprised. No, I suppose it makes sense, really. It's not as far as it looks. Generally, I'm happy enough to kill any dwarves here. I don't care what they are. Any one of these dwarves can take a javelin. They're all worth it in my mind. And, you know, these reclaimers, once they've thrown all of their axes, they take out those big old two-handed axes that we're seeing now. Wow, they are beautiful weapons, aren't they? And my textures are only on medium, and that still looks gorgeous. So there was a break, a substantial break from that position. So I've had to get the Goblin King bodyguard coming in, which I really didn't want to do right now. But we got them up, and these Mountain Orc Berserkers are locked morale. Get some Goblin Infantry just to hopefully keep my Goblin King bodyguard alive a little bit longer. And I saw these Sapphire Bladesmen, but they were out of ammunition. Some still to go, but oh no, they had to fight their way here. How effective is that fire? Because that's exceptional. Makes my Snaga Skirmishers look silly. Here's my next unit of Snaga Skirmishers coming up. I was surprised at just how long their ammunition was lasting here. And they were taking arrow fire too. I was more than happy to. I was really an ammo sponge for a lot of this, which I think when you're playing the Orcs in the Misty Mountains on the attack, that is kind of your duty. Oh, good fire, my friend. Yeah, cool. Because I knew he'd moved them up, but I wasn't really seeing how many shots they were putting in. But they're doing so much more damage than my boys will be, so that's cool to see. General is right on the he is almost right on the front line, so I was pretty scared about that, but these units are not like massive damage. See what we have going on with my wargs. When did I do that? Are they already dead, maybe? No, they're not. My trolls, I'm gonna actually slow down because I think I am missing something. And I'm almost dead. So I get my last unit of trolls again moved over on this side. Perhaps they would have been more beneficial on up there, but I was scared about the reclaimers just coming on in and cleaving them down with their big heavy axes. So I thought, once again, got some elves over here, not got much AP, let's do it. And I didn't spot the boys. Elven King's Palace Guard. To be absolutely honest, when people do give them the armor upgrade, I don't see them as easily, because they blend in with all of the Hiri units. And so if I would see that, and I from just a quick glance, which I do when I'm playing, I would just think, oh, they're the Hiri line. Don't worry about that. But they're actually going to be cutting down my snow trolls like nothing, seeing they're falling now really easily. So that was definitely a good unit to use to cleave them down. This guy's down up there too, and these will be the last of my trolls there. Just about all of my trolls have fallen on these walls or just through here. Still got one or two of them there. I think we actually got a cool confrontation for a while. We missed it, unfortunately, but my trolls, it was over here. I had about four trolls charge the final end, which was this guy here, and this final end just body slammed two of my trolls, which I was really upset about. So this is a nice big blob, and especially elven units do have the range to hit them from that wall right into here. So I was a bit scared about this, and I did try to spread them out, but there's only so much spreading you can do when you're on a wall. Not too many trolls left over there. What do we have here on the front line again? A lot of gobos. Gobo infantry, but I was quite impressed with the Mountain Orc Berserkers. I primarily took them for the AP. I never really take Mountain Orc Berserkers, but I thought, I know I'm going to be going up against a lot of dwarves, so let's do it. Let's make sure we've got some AP, but their locked morale makes me really fond of them. especially for a siege again, you know, they're coming in, I know every one of them is going to die on the front line. They're not getting scared away. Or at least not very easily at all. Lots of axes coming to the back of these Snag of Stalkers, but again, I was okay with that. And you can see I'm down to 9 of these crossbows there, and those crossbows are wavering. So in my mind, I'm sitting there thinking, still, as long as they stay. But I should have seen how shaken they were getting, how badly they were wavering. And I should have just pulled them out of the fight for a while. Just don't expose them to ammunition for a little while, just so to make sure they use up all of their ammo. Because right now they've still got about half of the unit's ammo left. And that will take a very long time for 9 men to use up. More sentries moving forward, but again, that's just a tempting target for my Snagga. These guys are out of ammo, but that's 150 boys. 150 bodies, small bodies, probably pretty malnourished. But hey, they can still be thrown on the front line all the same. I do like how that looks. How does it look when we close in? Nice and tight. Ooh, that's tasty. Quick scan across the battlefield, as I say. Let's just see what's going on. Ooh, underground a bit. Numenor, yeah. I'm a big fan of Numenor. I only use them in pitch battles, so I don't really like them on sieges. Not that there's anything wrong with them in sieges. Just not my sort of thing. Ooh, it's strange that we go under the ground for that little bit. Got a bit of a push here by Mordor. Again, coming in some Numenorians, some seafarers there, and some wardens of Amon Lank too. Coming over here, we luckily didn't have to face those. They would have cut down my trolls. Royal Guard there with their fire arrows. The Saurons, well, are tough to break, but they're wavering there, as you can see. Which this is a very scary thing to go up against. They are definitely the type of unit you want to be hacking through the Numenorian armor, but they don't have any shields, and they'll die pretty quick to this fire. But no, as I say, if you want to see how this assault generally goes, just make sure you watch the Scout's video. I'm more focusing on me. More javelins coming in. As I say, when you've got 3 nice beefy units of Snag of Stalkers, which I generally would suggest you take when you're on the attack or on the defense, it's just, they're so dang cheap, you know, and unless you really screw up with them, like this is my style, I love exposing them to arrow fire, like what's happening here, because I don't care, as long as there's still 50 of them left in the unit, I'm fine with that, you know, use your axes on them, use your arrows on them, I'm fine. If they rout, they'll probably come. And if they don't, that's 354 units I've lost. These 42 men here, though, were starting to get pretty dicey. They might be routing off sometime soon before they use all of their ammo, but hopefully they get all used. They're getting pretty thin on the ground here, but all I've killed so far here are really the Khazad Dûm's fodder. Or the Khazad Dûm's main line. There's no fodder when it comes to a dwarf. Some people may say that miners are fodder. I don't even believe that's the case. I think they really do serve a better purpose than just fodder. So we broke them here, and I wanted to wipe this unit out a bit. So I do lurch forward with my goblin infantry. But the Sons of the Fallen emerge. Now I've got a fear of the Sons of the Fallen. I've faced off against them a lot in situations, and I rarely come out on top. They're just not fun to fight. So I wanted to take this middle ground here, but there's just a handful of the shield guard remaining that stopped me from doing so. So the Heavy Goblin Spears, this is my last fully fresh unit of Heavy Goblin Spears. Spearman versus Spearman coming forward. But the Sons of the Fallen are a bit better than standard Spearmen, as they really sort of have this sword. They're more sword staff type of men. 4 Goblin Crossbowmen there, and as I say, they've still got about half of their damn ammo. So I'm getting just too risky with them, and they might end up routing off. Shield guard break, and I'm able to lurch up and just get some men onto this flat ground. But even then, he's been very careful with his positioning here. He's not rushed forward to have a fight on the flat ground. He's made sure that he's on the slant. And to my already exhausted men, this is an issue. Because keep in mind, these men are totally fresh. The Axe Guard coming forward as well, they could have been troll killers. We're seeing a lot of shaking. I don't use troll drummers, which is something a lot of guys point out, and I it makes sense. I get that. I don't like their expensive as hell. That's a grand that I could be spending on anything, and it's I know that, like, yeah, okay, but I'll be keeping everybody in the fight for longer. But what I always do is I make sure that my general, my bodyguard, is always right in the thick of the fight, and they buff morale. Now, I know getting both of them, you know, would be much more effective, but I personally think this strategy works for me, not bringing troll drummers. And I would definitely recommend to people that do like the Orcs of Misty Mountains and just feel they always need to bring it, just try not, just for one fight, see how it all goes. It'll probably turn out bad, but, you know, just at least try it. You see, I'm trying to push through, but the Sons of the Fallen aren't budging. It was a bit stupid of me to try and... Oh, okay, good. Right. So we did, as you can see, we tried to advance forward. All I wanted to do here was hold the Hiriek and maybe get some of the Greenwood Rangers. And we lost a lot of guy to arrow fire because I had to walk through here. And then, you know, I had to sort of run to the side. A few of the guys got caught and they ended up routing. And they routed right into the Greenwood Rangers. It would have been absolutely lovely, even if I had just made contact with those 17 wargs. That could have killed off a bunch of them, could have stopped them firing, because right now those guys are absolutely ripping apart this line. You can see, of course, a lot of these corpses were just killed in melee, but a lot of those were good shots from those rangers. Mountain or coast there, I'm just wanting to try and kill a few of these palace guard. And I'm really not wanting those palace guard to come all the way around and strike my back, because that would immediately shatter. All the while, though, you know, it's I think he's missing out on something here. Like, he could have a unit here that would activate these two towers, and he could have another one there, and that would activate these two towers. And maybe that's a bit overkill, but having a unit somewhere near here would activate this tower. It's I personally don't like towers and sieges. I love Dale. I love taking Dale, but I don't like the towers. I don't enjoy them. And but since they're there, you should use them. I'm trying to pull my bodyguard back because I don't want a general kill right now. And you can see, like, as soon as I've sort of really run out of ammunition, yeah, almost run out of ammunition, I'm really starting to struggle here. Some of my routing wargs there coming back. It would have been nice if they were standing, but the hammerers just split them in two again. Hammerers, great troll killers. Damn, those hammers look good. Dwarves do know how to make nice little weapons, I suppose. So yeah, these are of course not towers, but yeah, I just think with all of this going on, having those four towers just hammering into my position here would have killed a lot more guys over the course of this entire confrontation. But of course it would have meant having two units sitting here, but there's units in reserve that could have been doing that. I don't know. Sort of up to you what you think is best, I suppose. And as we're only 17,000 frames in, and I'm almost done. Like, that's kind of the scary thing. These men, they're fallen ward. Oh, your neck, my friend. That's funny. Since they're shorter than people, I guess they have the normal death animation, and it's trying to make sense of it. Oh gosh, they look creepy, don't they? Let's try and get a nice shot of him. Oh, good. Nice. Yeah, I guess it's trying to make sense of them. But Sapphire Bladesmen are good in melee, but they can't be the elders of the Elven King. Like, yeah, they're doing alright, but anything that we can to just chip away at those elite units is going to benefit us later. But at this point, like, really, Ruin and I are struggling. We're at 40 for 39, and that's normal, I think, in especially considering my numbers. You know, all of my numbers are gone. And generally, even Mordor is better quality than I am. Like, we're seeing a lot of these Saurons. Well, here's something that perplexed me a little bit. Umbar came over here to push. And it's funny. I wonder why. Anyway, yeah. Umbar came over there. Now, I know why he did that. It's always tough to get through here by yourself. But I just think, you know, we had four armies. We had four players coming into this main area. It's all right to be a one man coming down the bridge by yourself. I love doing that. You know, I joke about it a lot, but I really like to control my own push and not really rely on anybody else. It's fun to play by my like play my own game and just play my own speed. Yeah, I mean, I guess he saw that the boys over there could have used a bit of a hand to push through, but like still, I just think, you know, we need you to come through, and we need you to come through strong. Like, not that you're doing that, but like when I say come through strong, I mean come through and you've still got a lot of men there ready to push. Whereas right now, you know, he's got enough numbers to break through that gate. But then once he gets through there, you know, he just doesn't have enough to get through the next gate. Was all that, you know, I was thinking. But of course, during the battle, I wasn't looking at this. I didn't know. What do we have going on? Finally, the good old fearmongers came on forward, and I was chuffed to bits with how they were doing. They did a really good job against these Sons of the Fallen, and seeing how well they did, I was like, I wish I'd got them up sooner, because the Sons of the Fallen were just destroying me for a while. I've got a few winded units just trying to rest up. There's no point in throwing them in the fight right now. The crossbowmen, well, they're still standing with four of them left, but they're wavering, and well, you've only got four men. As soon as they run, they're gone. What we got here, the bodyguard. I'm just wanting to. They're close enough. They've got a 25-meter morale buffing zone. It's very small, so they do need to be very close. But I didn't want them on the front line because I was scared. That's all there is to it. I didn't want to lose them because I knew as soon as I lost my general, this position was falling. And then the fearmongers as well. They're morale buffing too. So I don't know. I guess I treat my morale buffs in the same way as I treat my Cardolan morale buffs. Just make sure that wherever a fight is happening, you have an elite unit in there. Instead of having the troll drummers, where it is like, well, I guess that's the job of the Hearthguard of Vamon Sul. You know, that's what they do. So it's fair enough. The fearmonger is now that we're facing the reclaimers. We're gonna go back up to normal speed now, I think. What is he firing all the way at? Again, my Snaga. At this point, I was just happy enough to be the ammo sponge. These men don't have much ammo left. They're firing right through a tree, of course. You know, that's good. I don't think that tree will stop their shots. At least I really don't think it does. If it is, then I'm very. No, I'm seeing a few javelins coming from there. That's good. Fearmonger is coming sort of in and out of doing good and bad right now. So, but what I was just dreading was these bad boys, First Legion Pikes. As good as the fearmongers are, I knew as soon as the First Legion are put into the fight, I'm gone. I'm wiped out. So I was just trying to kill off as much as I could before he decided to push them forward. That's quite a good shot he's got, actually, with those archers. Yeah, they're coming straight in. Good stuff. So I'd say I'm really running on fumes at this point. I'm just trying to drag it on, because as soon as I'm done, the dwarves are going to be able to just take off their men and shift them here against Mordor, or in this area up against the sort of mainly Umbar now, but also Mordor push. Got some Naharrim from Nomal, and some Uruk-hai archers as well. Raining some fire down. The Olokai getting thrown on forward. Not much AP around. So again, yeah, pretty good shout, I would say. The Rumena bows at this close range, yeah, I would be tempted to give them a quick volley with the Rumena bows. The Sentinels are pikemen. Very damn good pikemen, but they're still pikemen, so it's not really what you want up against the troll unit. The Farsim Swordmasters will do pretty good. As I said, even though an elite unit like that doesn't have AP, it's still going to do some good damage up against a unit of trolls. So as I say, there's not too much more tactical I have to talk about here. Yeah, Fearmonger is coming on in, just jabbing and smashing. So I'm probably going to just hide myself up here probably, and go into 2x speed for a bit. These crossbows finding a good arc right into that front line. Ah, there we are. Yep, this is what we were worried about. This is what we were seeing coming for a while. But finally, so I have another. Well, I've got you know, the 112 snagger, just coming forward, really just to be numbers alongside the alongside my pikemen, not pikemen, sorry, halberdiers, the fearmongers. And but I as soon as I see the pikes, I know it's over. Even with this crossbow fire, and oh no, they're out of ammunition now too. You could argue definitely that I probably should have saved ammunition for something like this, because I did know it was a threat. But I just feel if I hadn't used up my ammunition against the blobs that I did, I wouldn't have even gotten this far. So it's hard to say. We do have some crossbow fire, which I'm very grateful for, as it's really taking on these guys quite quick. But as soon as they make contact with my line, I'm going to be going down. Snag a skirmisher is actually enjoying that fight there. Good on them. They're really just there to, you know, every swing that a reclaimer spends on a skirmisher is one less that's coming down cracking on the head of a fearmonger. So I'm just, that's the thing. Oh, we've got the reclaimers and the axe guard there. Actually, I don't know which one of those is better in melee. Khazad-dûm is, I don't play as the dwarves very often, but Khazad-dûm is definitely the lesser of the two dwarves that I play. When I do enjoy Erebor. Okay, so here we go. The final clash, or what will be the final clash, as soon as the pikes get pushed in. And also the hammerers coming in too. I think this is definitely a good idea to kind of, don't just feed formation, don't just feed battles with like one or two units at a time. Well, one unit at a time. Like when you want to make an impact, which he does see now, he's got the strength to shut me down. Coming in with two of these units now. You see my men are already breaking there. I'm getting my Goblin King bodyguard, trying to get him stuck right into the fight now. Good kill by those, were those Temple Executioners? Yeah. They might have been Temple Guard, but I think those swords were a bit bigger than the Temple Guard swords. Yep, so he's just pushing into me. The hammers are good to bad. It's just the dwarven mass. They can just work their way in. I'm trying to match that with my Goblin King bodyguard here, but they just can't. Yep, and this is it. When the white Uruks are starting to rout, that's it over. Goblin King bodyguard, hopefully going to go down fighting, but nope. That's 31! 31 members of the Goblin King bodyguard routing from the fight. And he's what just chased me down, which I think is a good idea. How many? Yeah, he takes them down to 7 just from that push there. I think they would have come back with 31. They are not coming back with 7. Now here's the thing, he gets a bit overzealous with these hammers. Now maybe his attention is focused elsewhere, but he just runs on out. Now this is something you need to be very careful about as a defender. You have your walls, you are safe within your walls. The moment you step out, even like as little as the attackers may have left, the moment that you step out, you need to be very damn careful, because that is no longer your house. And you know, you're really stepping into the attacker's playing field at that point. So I called those hammerers to the attention here of Numal and or Noamal, and he's got these in his room, which they're very nice and juicy, and they've not been used yet. So they are the perfect unit to often deal with that. Urukai Reavers there. They're doing pretty damn good, to be honest, but up against these spears, but they're just taking shots from towers, and also like, I think the occasional volley, no, maybe not, but their lack of armor is just going to make them drop like flies to that tower fire. So these spears, this is a good shout from Mirkwood. But yep, now that I am I'm off the field, yeah, so you see he's coming on in, and you can see just sort of how deep he's gotten with these hammerers. He just didn't, you know, I can see why, you know, you think this is a very elite unit. That's quite a beefy unit left. You can see why you'd think they might come back. So you'd prefer to just chase them down. But like, the risk I would feel about this is, by the time my hammerers finally get back, they're going to be exhausted. So it's just, I don't really necessarily think it's worth it. I just sort of want to see this one charge, because it was a pretty risky choice taking a unit of Innis Rim on the attack to Dale. I've actually been in My first time playing on Dale, I was on the attack again, playing as the Misty Mountains. And my ally brought two units of Lancers. He brought the Dragon's Breath Cannon. He didn't bring any other siege equipment. It was his first game ever. So he just, he was a bit silly with his army composition. But we did manage to win that fight. I was really, really chuffed. Because even though he had brought just the worst possible army to get the job done, you know, we all managed to bound together, and we got it done. So no, that was nice. I'm gonna probably jump up to about 2 speed because it's generally a bit of a grind fest now, and just need to find a nice place. So as I said, I had nothing left at this point, and which is often sort of what I do as a siege attacker. I kind of like to be the, even though I do generally like to take my time, when stuff gets started, I really do like to do my part. And I think I generally did in this fight. It sucks. If anybody isn't aware of this, I'm 14 desynced. So we don't have our ending screen battle, you know, in the end battle screen. Which is too bad, because it would have been nice to sort of run through generally what my units were killing. I think I got like 1,600 or something like that, but that's just a number that is on my mind. Oh hell, that's a good shot. Oh, that's the Corsair Fencers going down. Ah, oh, gosh damn. I like the Corsair Fencers. I don't see them too often, to be honest, from Umbar. I guess I don't. When I play Umbar, I like to play them more in the sense of like Black Numenoreans, rather than. Or not so much Black Numenoreans, but I like to play them very much as like the descendants of Numenor, rather than as pirates. I think in 9.6, this is a kind of cool change, I think, really. Like in 9.6, they were very, or I felt that they were very much pirate boys, with a few very exceptional, Numenorean descendant units mixed in. Whereas now, I think of them more as Numenorean descendant units with a few pirate boys mixed in. You know, it's a bit of a different situation with them now, and that's certainly not a bad thing. And it, as I say, it agrees with the way that I used to play them anyway. But it's kind of, yeah. But I'm glad that we can still do that. I still do like to switch up to, you know, specials sometimes, where, you know, we can get units like the Corsair Savages again, and you can make a very pirate army. I've got a free-for-all from, oh god, like 2 months ago now, I think, probably, in which I play Umbar, and I do that. I play Umbar and I play them very, very pirate focused, which is quite fun. Numal's coming over here with his lack of ammunition. I think maybe Numal brought too much ranged to this fight. I think you can definitely do that sometimes, especially, as I say, with Dale. My attack strategy for Dale is different than my attack strategy with everybody everywhere else, and the reason for that are the towers. If Dale didn't have towers, I would assault it in the same way as I do everywhere else, which is come forward with fodder class archers, lose all of my fodder class archers, and then make my attack with my infantry. My infantry play is quite good. It's certainly not the best, but it's quite good. And generally, I know that if I use up my enemy's ammunition, I've got a pretty good chance of winning that fight. Whereas if my enemy's still got ammunition, I'm done. Even though I think my infantry-to-infantry play is quite good, my infantry safety play sucks. So I will always expose my men to fire. And there's a Bursagath siege that I did recently. I won't be making a video on it, I don't think it was quite close enough to do that. And but I was up against a Mirkwood player, Sharkan was blooming good with his ammunition. Every time I thought he was out of ammunition, no, he wasn't. He still had a few more volleys left, and he just kept nicking away at my guys, which was really annoying. And I went to so much effort to just get all of his ammo used up. And then, just as I'm moving up my pikes, it's like, oh, by the way, I've still got like 3 volleys left. Damn, damn, damn. My blooming Witcher on pikes are down to like half health. So Thranduil is coming on back now, and there's something that's kind of cool. They actually kind of don't really defend the middle layer at all, which I think is sensible. Primarily because I think the back gate has fallen altogether. Yeah, when the back gate falls, there's really no point in defending the mid layer. You really should just fall back to the final choke point. What's going on here? We got a Seafarers and Endemol. Yeah, to be honest, mate, like if they turned around and attacked, they would wipe this unit out. Makes sense that they don't, but you can see the temptation for sure, because you know you could just wipe out that Alcron Death Legion and then keep on going to take out the Blackguards and the Royal Guard to stop them from using their ammo. But that would mean that just actually looking at this now, I think I was wrong in that assessment. But yeah, everything here is just sort of waiting for all these men to come back so they can all head inside together where they will be nice and safe. We're at 75 for 76, which is still, we are ahead, but we still have one more position to break through. And all the while as well, like you're hearing it twanging away there, this tower is still functioning. Why isn't that tower still functioning? Who is near enough to that tower to function? It annoys me, like, you don't, this is one thing, maybe I've just got the settings turned off for it, but, like, there's usually little flags above towers to let you know that they're active, and we don't get that, so that's something that I maybe need to look into turning on if that is a setting, just so I do know which towers are and are not active before they start shooting. I was on the defense, which is very unusual for me. I much prefer to be on the attack, but I was on the defense of Dale, along with a dwarven ally in a 3v2 battle. And that was a lot of fun, but did we crash out? Yeah, we crashed out. I think it was just the general like Tuesday night crash shenanigans that occurred, and that was really upsetting because that was a fun siege. And I think we were going to lose. But it was going to be close. It was going to be damn close. I was really impressed with... this always sucks to say. I was really impressed with myself. But like, I think I did a really good job at just basically using the secondary walls to support my outer wall fights with my archers. I was playing as Dale. So, you know, I had such a big emphasis on my archers. Because Dale has a big... A lot of their archers are competent in melee, which I think is really great for a siege, because once you've used up your ammo, your men are men at arms. And also, like, I had my Bardian marksmen on the outer walls, and they were just, you know, when the enemy climbed up, the Bardian marksmen were taking out their swords and stabbing away and winning fights. So that was great. I was chuffed to bits with him. Oh, yeah, no lag, don't worry. I'm not too worried about crashes anymore, especially, you know, this is on medium unit thingy, I think. Yeah, I tried to run this before, but it's just the amount of buildings that stopped me from running on full graphics, which is too bad, because I do like running things with full settings. A lot of good fire here from these Variag mercenaries. I'm wondering why he's sort of doing... Oh yeah, there was one thing. So this is something that kind of perplexed me. These men are getting shot by that tower, and it's coming down. Yeah, you're seeing that there. There's arrows, though there are arrows, coming down from there, and they're coming from this tower. So that tower is able to shoot through this ramp and strike them. So that's, well, I guess it's just a warning out there. I really worry that, say, if I had archers positioned here, would they be able to do the same, or is that just a tower thing? But no. This final defense, though, so we do have the balance of power is in our favor. We're 76 for 77, we're above them, and we do have units coming in from both sides. We're breaking down this gate here, and we're getting ready to, well, form up on this gate. But it's just the units that the enemy have left that scare the hell out of me at this point, with all of their first legion pikes and so on. But something we do have is the fire of Orthanc. And, oh yeah, also, our troll catapult was bugging out like crazy. Oh, all those guys. Nice, nice. Yeah, I don't even know where it is. There it is. Yeah, our troll catapult was bugging out like crazy. Jeepers, save, we still got 20,000 frames. I won't be going right to the very end, because as I say, it's just, there's only one more thing that I really want to touch on, but it happens at like 45,000 frames, so we'll get to it, but after that we'll probably close it off. What we've got is generally, I will probably put like a statement in the description that basically everything after X is just rambling, because I have been rambling for the past 10,000 frames, so we will make sure that is known. Remena infantry charging at us, that's pretty good, chasing off those archers. So exposing yourself to a lot of fire here, I don't know if I'd be doing that. Oh, and the Ennis Rim. If the Ennis Rim are fast, they can do some damage here. Even though that's a curl around, you're kind of looking for any possible charge. You know, like, you're not going to get the best charge in the world, but you're hoping you can get something. No, dang it, they weren't able to. Oh well, still, pretty good. All in all though, I think we've all handled this pretty well. I definitely wish I had. I don't know. I don't know what I could have done better. I think because of the amount of spearmen I had, I think it was unnecessary that I brought the nukes. You know, I always feel that I need a unit to counter enemy cav, just in case they charge out at us. But we were fighting today Mirkwood, Khazad Dûm, and Numenor. With the exception of the Sindar of the Girdle, there's really only one unit that I'm... that's the only unit. The Sindar of the Girdle are the only unit that I'm genuinely scared about coming out and trying to charge us down. And if the Sindar came out, my works would be ripped in pieces anyway. So I probably should have just seen that and thought, yeah, this is pretty good actually. He's able to get some good shots with his archers. That'd be the right side, so their shield won't be coming into effect. I think, because that's 754 florins, and I could have gotten rid of that, and in place of 754 florins, I could have gotten another unit of Mountain Orc Berserkers, maybe? I don't know. I don't know if they're like more expensive than that or not. But yeah, you know, that could have been an option. But still, like anything, maybe I need to consider taking like the Warg Skirmishers instead sometimes, in order to be like, okay, the enemy don't have any archers. The enemy don't have any cav. I might as well just throw my javelins at them. Now that is why I absolutely love the Coldfell Maidens when I'm playing as Rudaur on the assault, because if the enemy don't have any cav, then I've still got a bunch of women that I can charge around and just throw javelins into the enemy front line, and it's just more throwing weapons, more AP throwing weapons, which I think is always kind of what I like on a siege assault anyway. And whereas, you know, and I could kind of do the same with my Warg Skirmishers then. But the thing is, Warg Skirmishers, I don't think they have an anti-cavalry bonus. It doesn't list that they have an anti-cavalry bonus, whereas Coldfell Maidens do. So, I don't know. Coldfell Maidens also have a shield, which is nice, and some semblance of armour. So, that benefits them quite a lot. I swear I'm not just trying to think up excuses to have more QTs in my army. See, the whole thing here is we're constantly just taking tower fire, which isn't much, but you know, it's something, and our men are just constantly going to be dropping back here, and the enemy are not suffering anything for this. They're not taking, yeah, we're seeing, oh right, that's okay, the Snag of Skirmishers is taking this damage. I like that the Snag of Skirmishers are different for the Isengard and for the Orcs in the Nessie Mountains. I've always kind of, I don't know, like, it's not that I don't like the look of them, it's that I prefer the look of the Misty Mountain ones. But I think that the darker green, and they've even got, like, a lot of them have the white hand on them. That's pretty cool. I don't really know if I'd put a white hand on a Snagga. Seems, I suppose everybody's playing their part, you know. Even, you know, a little slave just carrying a stick to throw at people. Shadow Bow's there out of ammunition, just teasing out some arrow fire. I'd be keen. Oh, no, it's unnecessary. I was gonna say I thought that front line was bigger. The Nazgul are still working around. So at this point, in a sense, we've got the numbers, but they've already charged out and met Umbar here. Now, as I say, this is the issue, because Umbar sent so much around the side to assist the allies. This is a risk, and he's paying for this now. The NSRM can't do anything here because they can't charge through them. So it really is just a rip, which is unfortunate, because as soon as they're done here, they can just turn around and there's nothing more that they have to worry about from this side. You know, the NSRM could charge in here, but I guess just like take sentinels. There's not many sentinels, just take like 30 sentinels. You're not going to be losing much on the front line, and they'll just hold this force back. So it's just, it was unfortunate. I'm sure his assistant was very valuable over on the east, but I think it's always better. You know, when you're coming in a place by yourself, there's a lot of trust on that. You know, there's a lot of like, you know, yes, you're going to come in there by yourself. We're not worrying about you. You're take your time type thing. Okay, cool. So he has caught. It's just the fact that the enemy sentinels are still alive. If there weren't, and the sentinels are up front, is the problem too. So that's, the Innistrim are just not going to find an option here, I don't think. They're going to try. Nah, man. As well as that, it's just the slightly, it's not really too unbalanced. If they came right here-ish, yeah, they're sort of coming out, and then if he turns around and charges back in, but leading the charge with the sentinels, all he can do is try and go straight into it, but he's gonna, I don't know. Ah, crap. Okay, missed it. The one thing I was waiting for. This powder cart, or the, not powder cart, the Fire of Orthanc. We were chatting, and we were trying to work out what was best to do. And I said that the best option would be to send the powder cart at the gate. Because best case scenario, you kill them defending the gate. Worst case scenario, they'll run away from the gate. And then we get right in before they can form up properly. Now, that was when Mark, the Mark of the Night, pointed at this wall. And he said, no, use it here. Now, it had unfortunately already gotten like in here by that point, but had we used it there, we could have busted open that wall, and they would have had two ways in, which I think was exactly what we would need. Now, I think it's, because I think if we had two ways in, we could have just, I don't know. I don't think it would have been a win still, but it would have meant that they couldn't have fought using those two units of pikes together. Those two units of pikes, one would have had to be here, one would have had to been here, and we would have been, it would have been a lot easier to swap them. As well as that, had we kept the troll catapult, now that wasn't anybody's fault, the troll catapult just got bugged out, but say if the troll catapult had busted in like this wall, that'd be three entrances we have. Now I think if we had gotten three entrances, yes, we could have done it. Lord Black, because keep in mind, Lord Blackwell's got most of his army left at this point, so he could have pushed three entrances at once. But coming in all at one place, the First Legion pikes, you can't push through dwarves, not well. Especially not the first damn legion, and no, there's just too much. Poor old trolls there, just picked away at by the hammers. Going to bad, you can see that's why like I'm just scared to use them against AP units, so. No. All in all though, yeah, this video has gone on a lot longer than I originally expected it to, or intended it to, but as I say, I'll put a timestamp in for it. You should probably stop watching here. thank you guys. I'll be trying, as I said, to get out. I'll immediately, as soon as I've done this one, when this is processing, I'll be recording another that I'll get out on Saturday, and then hopefully I'll get another one out on Sunday. Just to try and make up for basically a week of absence, because I've just been dead. And I've had to pause the recording about four times in order to take like sniff breaks and blow my nose. But all in all, it's not painful, which is, that's the main thing. Anyway though, fun siege. Love using the orcs in this mountains, always do. Fun to use them on the attack. Would definitely recommend it if you haven't already. And Thank you very much.